Valleys People, episode 16, duration 1 by 30 minutes, recorded 15th of the 11th, 81, replay date to be advised.
Hello and welcome again to the Valleys People. Today we're going to meet a man from Toronto who knows more about the RAAF base at Rathmines during the war than any other person we could ask along to the show. And also from Newcastle, someone who's made things a little different in Tibooburra, New South Wales, since he went gold prospecting electronically. And that should be a fascination to meet him too. I hope you can join us today when we meet two more people from the Valley. Thanks for being with us today. The introduction to our first guest really begins with this aerial photograph from 1938, an aerial photograph, Lake Macquarie, of Rathmines. And our first guest is the man that took that photograph. He's with us today as something of an expert on the Rathmines base, John Newtown. Welcome to the Valleys People.
Thank you, John.
Now, John, how were you taking photographs of Lake Macquarie from the air for the RAAF in 1938?
Well, they had decided in May that they would form a base at Rathmines. And I was asked to come up in October in 1939, this was, to photograph the base, do a photographic survey, in other words.
Right.
And this is why I took this photograph.
And you were taking various photographs of Lake Macquarie and the coastline
We did take some at Salamander Bay, but they had decided on Rathmines, although Salamander Bay was taken, but they decided on Rathmines, and this was the main photograph that was taken, which went to airboard.
Yes, a little bit of history there.
Oh, yes.
It wasn't the days of hanging out of aircraft taking aerial shots, was it?
Well, yes. The old ducks.
Oh, really?
The old pusher aircraft.
And do you know, John, how, in fact, the final decision in favour of Rathmines was made from the other considerations that surely were before them?
Well, the main thing, of course, was water. I saw a lot of writings on this in my research. And the main thing was the water was easy to take from Kilburn Bay, fresh water, I mean.
Yes.
Their first choice, number one choice, was Pelican at first.
Really?
But there was no water as easy as it could go across from Kilburn Bay to Rathmines.
Yes.
Plus the fact that Kilburn Bay was a really good landing spot.
Yes.
Well protected.
Yes. I understand that you're also a person that knows what happened in the history of every Catalina and every kingfisher and every walrus that ever went through Lake Macquarie.
Yes, I have a record of them all.
Really? That'd be a fascinating collection.
Oh, yes, yes.
You know those that were destroyed and those that crashed?
I know exactly what happened to them, where they came. Seagulls and walruses were two different aircraft, and they were very, very similar. The walrus was the English version of the seagull, the old pusher, duckers we used to call them.
Now, when did they start work on Rathmines, John?
Well, the first party went up there on the 4th of August 1939. It wasn't resumed till September 39 by the government.
Just before the Second World War outbreak?
Just about. I mean, just about that time.
Mm. And we were building it for what?
Well, we were building it as a seaplane base for Sunderlands. These were the Sunderlands we were getting from England. The 10th Squadron was formed in July 1940.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, that's the squadron that went over, wasn't
it? They went
it?
Over and to see
war broke
to pick
out.
Them up. That's right. 10th Squadron pilots went over and the crews went over to pick them up, the Sunderlands, but unfortunately war broke out and they decided to keep the Sunderlands. So we didn't have any Sunderlands.
No, and that was an Australian Air Force squadron in England fighting because they went to bring some planes back to Australia and
That's
war
correct.
Intervened. Yes.
That's correct.
Well then why did we make the decision to buy the famous Catalinas? They're an American aircraft, weren't they?
Well, they were the next best. Mm. If anything, I think they were better than Sunderlands because they had such a wonderful range.
And obviously Britain had no more aircraft to send.
Had nothing whatever.
Yes.
And they had been over previously to see this Taylor, Sir Gordon Taylor. He flew one, a very early model, across the Indian Ocean. and I think this may have helped a bit. But they went over and they decided on Catalina's, PBY-5s they were called, by Consolidated Aircraft Corporation.
Yes, and of course America being neutral, we couldn't very well go over in the Air Force plane and pick them up, could we?
This is where they got in touch with Qantas. Qantas pilots, they went over and they picked up the first 19. We could not go over and pick them up with our pilots. The fact that we didn't have any training in any case. We didn't have anybody trained in Australia that could fly those boats.
Yes. It also strikes me as being very fascinating, John. I don't know whether you've done any research on this, but at that particular time, we're talking about, 1940 now, aren't we? 1939, 1940.
41, the first
one. It wasn't a matter of sort of hopping on a jumbo and crossing the Pacific Ocean as we do now, or people, the airlines do two or three times a day.
No.
Was there any regular service across there?
Yes. They were flying regular services across. I've gotten who flew the service, but they did fly regular service across, and that's how they went over.
Mm.
That was afterwards, of course.
Mm.
But the Americans brought the first ones out. Qantas picked them up at Honolulu. The Americans flew them to Honolulu, and the Qantas boys picked them up from there. Lester Brain, he was the chief Qantas pilot. They brought the first 19 out, and then America came into the war.
Mm. Well, those that can remember of the war at Lake Macquarie, of course, can certainly remember Catalina's taking off night and day. The famous Black Cat Squadron, wasn't it called?
That's
they were
right.
All dark and black and nightly camouflage. Yeah. What was their main function, John?
Well, as far as the cats are concerned, training, patrol work, up north especially, because everybody that flew a cat up north was trained at Rathmines.
Really?
Every crew was trained at Rathmines.
No matter where they were posted, in the South Pacific, they were all trained there?
In Catalinas.
In Catalinas, yes.
Yes, in flying boats. Everybody was trained at Rathmines because that was a training station as well as a very big repair depot. All the main repairs were done at Rathmines.
Yes.
And also the boys at the sea rescue on the marine section.
Yeah, they the crash were boats around the lake, weren't they?
Crash boats.
Yes. Yeah. And how many Catalinas would we have had there over the period of the war?
168 we bought at about $150,000 each.
Yes, it's certainly cheap by aircraft standards
today,
aren't
yes.
They? Yes. Yes. Yeah, that's really fascinating. When the base was shut down, that was when, in the 60s?
The base closed down in 1960, November 1960.
And why was that decision taken, do you think?
Well, there were no more flying boats. See, after the war, all squadrons were cut down. Money wasn't as easy, I suppose, to keep the Air Force going. So many people got out of the Air Force. But flying boats were obsolete. So they decided there were no more flying boats. I think the only flying boats in Australia were flying to Lord Howe.
Yes, a few tourists have been in those, I think, over the years. But the Catalinas, what happened to them?
Well, a few of them were purchased and they flew for a little while up north in the islands on services around in between the islands. But most of them were sold. Those that were left.
What is it, scrap or?
Scrap.
Oh,
some were sold for different aircraft. Now Qantas bought a few, but they didn't keep them very long.
And
most of them were sold for scrap. Those that were left.
Yes, it's hard, isn't it? When today we seek so much of our heritage, and you expect to find a lot of these. After you said you had 160 plus. There don't seem to be any around at the moment. Did the War Museum in Canberra buy any?
No, we only have one at the moment, that is Frigate Bird. That's the one that Gordon Taylor went to Chile. You remember the trip he did across the Pacific?
Yes, it was a pioneering trip, wasn't it?
Yes, and that's the only one we have left. Now, that was the second last Catalina that came out. And Sir Robert Menzies gave him that one. He bought three, incidentally, earlier. But Robert Menzies gave him that one. And he did his trip to Chile, came back, and he gave it to the New South Wales government. And it was down at Camden for many, many years. It's at the Museum of Applied Arts and Sciences now, and we hope to restore it.
Yes, so there's one left.
One left, only.
At least you know where it is, that's something.
Yes, well, we hope to restore it.
Well, is the thing that strikes me, though, is that at Rathmines now, we've got the best boat ramp in Australia,
yes.
I guess. But it seems to be a terrible blow to our vision, doesn't it, that all this was just scrapped and thrown away?
Well, this is right, but this is what happened to thousands and thousands of aircraft in the RAAF alone that I know of. So a lot of them were leased land.
Yes. So they had to be destroyed under the terms of the agreement.
Yes.
Yeah. And how did you start to accumulate all these facts about Rathmines? Because everywhere you go, if you want to know something about Rathmines, you ask John.
Well, it all started one day. We were sitting there, about three or four of us, we were in the RSL at Toronto, and we're talking about Rathmines. And somebody said, well, I think somebody ought to write a book or write a record on it. And I don't know whether I was a volunteer or conscript. But I did a lot of work. I did about 2 years' research. Had a lot of help from friends that had been there. And there's a certain sense of achievement when I finished. I was happy with the job.
Yes.
Unfortunately, they're out of print now, but anybody really wants to read one, they can get it out of the library. There's one in the Newcastle Library or the Lake Macquarie Library.
Yes. It's good that all that now has been recorded. I mean, without foresight, we've destroyed the Catalinas and we've destroyed the barracks and we've destroyed most of the buildings, except a few permanent ones out there, so there's nothing left but concrete. But now at least we have this history recorded, John.
Well, I can guarantee the history is authentic because I really and truly went into it, studied a lot, and I just didn't take it from somebody told me, word of mouth. I checked everything I could find.
Yeah.
And I don't think I'll be shot down in flames.
No, I think the most fascinating thing about it is that there were you, a RAAF man, a serviceman in the 38-39, flying up and down the coast taking photographs, aerial photographs, for someone, the CO or someone else, not realising that so many years later you'd have to put all this together again.
Well, you don't realise these things are on now.
No. Anyway, John, it's our pleasure to know that this has been listed now for all time, the full history of RAAF Rathmines through your efforts. The men that served there, 3,000 of them? At least 3,000 during the war. And 160 plus aircraft. It's been a fascinating achievement of yours. Our congratulations. John Newton, our first guest in today's Valley People, and I'd like you to meet our second fascinating man in just a moment. Our next guest is a modern-day gold seeker, electronic gold detection, which is done through a machine that you've possibly seen, very similar indeed to the one that we have here today in the Valleys People. And we welcome to the show Darryl Jones.
Thank you, Ron.
I said in the introduction to the program, Darryl, that Tibooburra has never quite settled down since you took gold safaris there. You and your merry men and women too, who went searching for gold, where does your interest in gold seeking begin?
Well, my interests were really the very traditional interests in gold and the very traditional methods of finding gold. I was born in Bendigo and spent most of my early years there. My father was a gold miner. Both grandfathers were gold miners and some of my uncles are still down there and they still chase gold. So I was, brought up around the gold fields and always very interested in it. And I carried that interest when I shifted to live in Newcastle. And renewed the interest by prospecting trips up into the Barrington area. However, it wasn't until 1977 that I first heard about metal detectors, and I looked into them and found that they had some real potential if they were used in the right kind of country and could very well be used to find gold. So I set about unsuccessfully for the first 18 months travelling the various New South Wales old gold towns and finally realised that I was probably looking in all the wrong places. I should have known better, but the thing about the metal detector is that it responds to gold if it's in a nugget form, but the nugget must be it must be sizeable and it must be close to the surface. And that brings us to the Tibooburra trip. I'd been to Tibooburra early this year in the course of gathering information for a book that I'm preparing on gold and how to detect gold in Australia, and more particularly how to detect gold in New South Wales. And all the research that I'd done on the book indicated that Tibooburra, of all places, would be an ideal place to take a metal detector. It had the climate, which meant that it was a very, very low rainfall in Tibooburra, And this means that the method of working the Tibooburra gold was with the old dry washer, which was very inefficient. Further reading on the Tibooburra field showed that the gold was in nugget form, and it was also close to the surface, so it met all the criteria to find it with a detector.
Mm. Whereas people sort of charging off to Hill End and other places would be having to drive a shaft down to get in.
Well, that's exactly right. Yeah. And I was one of those ones in the early days, at least, looking in places like that. And of course, I think most people would be disappointed if they went to Hill End today with a metal detector, because the gold down there is in reef form and it's 200 feet or more below the surface, and the detector certainly can't operate to that depth, and if it did, well, the operator wouldn't be able to dig the hole. So Tibooburra, of all places, showed up as a place that we could go to and find gold, and we went there in June, and in a short period of time, I'd located five sizeable gold nuggets, and when I say sizeable, for me, that's a piece, say, a quarter of an ounce.
Well, is this sizeable, the sort of gold that you have here on the table?
Yes.
Is that what you'd call sizeable nuggets?
I certainly consider those to be sizeable. And although we hear a lot about the very large nuggets that are found every now and again in Victoria and Western Australia and sometimes in this state, I think the average person with a detector or the average prospector that found, you know, a quarter an ounce nugget, he'd be very pleased with that size. It's a sizeable one.
Well, the first picture we seem to get of Darryl Jones is selling electronic detectors at country shows. You were really pioneering something there, weren't you?
Yes, well, that's true, Ron. I had a lot of faith in the detector when I first saw them in 77 after running them up with some tests, and I felt that it was something that I also had a feeling that the price of gold would shift. I'd been watching it for some time, and it had every indication that it would lift, which it did, and that was very fortunate, because I considered that the detector was possibly a very undersold product that had quite a future in Australia. And I went to America and looked into the manufacturing of the top quality detectors in America, and brought a brand to Australia, introduced a brand that I felt could meet that criteria for finding gold, and that's history now. We've had some very exciting and spectacular finds in Australia.
Because I guess, I'm only assuming a situation, but I suppose when you first introduced them, you had the situation where virtually anyone, even without any gold experience as you may have had, bought one, and it was just a typical weekend out with the family, but they're a little more finely tuned than that, aren't they?
Yes, they're quite difficult to use initially, and that was one of the reasons that I've prepared this book, to help people use them properly. The ground itself gives off a lot of noise, and we call that ground noise, which is for the novice. He tends to think that every time he hears that ground noise, he's got a nugget, and consequently digs a lot of holes. The publicity that surrounded detectors in 79 in particular, I think a lot of people thought that they were a magic wand. And of course, there was a lot of skeptics that felt that they were a gimmick. Well, I think they're somewhere in between those two extremes, and given a lot of patience and research on an area, the detector will be rewarding for the person that bothers to go out and use it properly.
Well, what constitutes working properly, Darryl? Could you show us? I mean, what can it do in a sense? If you've got all these signals coming to you all the time, how do you just detect metals?
Okay, well, the very early detectors, they were just metal detectors, but technology has improved the detector to the point where it's able to differentiate, or we call it discriminate, between various types of metals. So if we could just demonstrate that.
So what you have here is a typical modern detector.
This is a typical detector that we use successfully on the gold fields to locate gold in difficult countries such as ironstone country, and it's capable of penetrating that ironstone, at the same time detecting any metal, and then on top of that it can differentiate or discriminate the type of metal. So
now you've got a readout there on the top, haven't you, which shows you whether it's trash or treasure.
Yes, on this newer sophisticated type, it has a center swing needle, and by applying a degree of bias on the discriminator, we can determine where the metal will come up in the needle. So
firstly, some trash.
Some trash with the horseshoe. We'll get a response to say there's metal present, and In that case, the needle went directly across to the trash.
So you have nothing to dig up, it's a horseshoe.
Well, we can assume it's possibly a ferrous or Coca-Cola can or whatever.
Now a gold nugget.
Now, with a gold nugget, the detector's capable of detecting the gold, and in this case, the audio comes on and the needle deflected to the green zone. So it was able to detect the metal and discriminate and give us some indication whether the metal was worth digging or not.
Well, any gold, or what about this gold wedding ring? Would that work?
Any gold at all, Ron.
Really?
Yes.
I'll just put this in front of it and, yeah, well, detecting that, isn't it?
Right.
Because it's only carat gold.
Right.
Cheap one.
Yes, well, the actual detectors were originally designed to locate lost coins, which they do an exceptionally good job of, and the Australians have used them almost exclusively to find gold nuggets. We're very fortunate in Australia that there's so many places that these can be used successfully, and some of the finds have been, I'm sure you've seen, have been quite spectacular. Hmm.
So they weren't originally gold detectors in the United States?
No, that's the amazing thing. They were designed in the United States. 95% of all detectors sold are used by people that either search for coins or Civil War artifacts and relics. And it was the Australians that showed the way with the metal detector as a prospecting device, and some United States detector owners are now starting to find that some of the old United States gold fields, especially up in Alaska, the detector is now being used in America for that reason, but primarily for coins.
The price of silver, you might turn the cycle going again, Darryl. We could look for old two-shilling pieces.
I'm sure if most people realise just the value of the pre-decimal Australian currency, for instance, right now with the silver price quite low, around about the $9 an ounce, that still puts the average pre-decimal two-shilling piece at around about $3.40 of scrap silver. And I think that the average Australian wouldn't possibly be aware that the old two-bob bit was worth so much.
Yeah, well, what's the rate of success of one of these, really? I mean, the picture is that they walk in and they buy a detector and go out and get their fortune, but obviously there are more people that don't than do, for lots of reasons. But, I mean, what's the rate of success on a machine such
as that? Well, we've monitored that very closely, and I think the rate of success, if you're talking about coins, is almost instantaneous. There's so many coins lost on the beaches and parks that even the novice can go and find coins on his first day out. In respect to gold, the careful researcher, the detector owner that bothers to carefully research the location to go to, and then he learns how to interpret this ground noise problem and the discrimination, he can look to paying for his detector in less than 6 months. So I think it really comes back to the operator, Ron.
Yes.
That's the important thing.
There's one thing you might clear up for us once and for all. There are a lot of articles suggesting that this modern detector is a spin-off from the mine detector of the Second World War. Is that true?
Yes, we hear that a lot, but the actual original mine detector that was used in the Second World War is a development of the American coin detector.
Oh, really?
The Americans have been searching successfully with coin detectors for some 20-odd years before the development of the mine detector, so it's quite the reverse.
Well, Darryl, you keep on looking for gold nuggets. We're on your side. Wish we could join you. Darryl Jones, who's sort of leading the revolution in electronic gold detection and doing it quite profitably in New South Wales. Thanks very much for being with us today on The Valleys People, and I'll be back in just a moment. Our guest today in The Valleys People, firstly John Newton, who took a picture of Rathmines in 1938, not realising that it was become an Air Force base for which he was about to make history and record the full documentation of that base at Lake Macquarie. And also Darryl Jones from Newcastle, whose work with electronic gold detection has been something of a star in taking safaris to Dibbabara and other places, and is leading us into the electronic age of mineral discovery. Hope you've enjoyed these people, and I hope that you will Join us again when next we meet more of the Valley's people. Goodbye for now.